So in the previous session, we discussed about the first two strategy, that is ego efficiency and post beyond compliance leadership. Now we'll see what are the next two strategy that comes under the broad environmental strategy of the organization. So the first, the third strategy what we are talking about, that is eco branding. Now what is the focus of this strategy? The focus of this strategy is again creating a differentiation in the product and services. So if you remember the last two strategy what we are discussing, here the changes needed over the process, both in case of eco efficiency and the post compliance, beyond compliance leadership. But in case of eco branding, even if the focus is differentiation, but the changes needed over here is on the product and services. Now how the eco branding is defined? A firm differentiates itself from the competitor when it provides something unique that is valuable to buyers beyond simply offering at a lower price. So the typical typical definition of the product differentiation. Now the ecological oriented product and service represent a niche market explored by the firms worldwide, and the price of product is same or greater. In most of the cases we find the eco branded product or environmental friendly product, typically their pricing higher than the regular product in the typical range of the product. So here the product differentiation is bringing the concern of ecology or environmental concern, or it is known as the ecology oriented product or the environmental friendly product. Now the eco branding, once you produce environmentally friendly product or eco friendly product, then the next is that how do you brand them, or how do you create a identity for the product as a eco friendly product or the environmentally friendly product, that is through the eco branding. Now what is different for differentiation on environmental attributes? Because we have any product, if you look at in every product category, we have differentiated product available. But what is the, when you talk about product differentiation in this case, what is different over here? One, the typically if you look at any product, the appeal for a specific brand comes because of private benefit what we get from that brand. But in case of eco-friendly product, it gives both the private benefit and public benefit. The typical example is that if I am using an environmental friendly product, it gives me private benefit because the environmental impact associated with that is less. The types of inputs, the type of resources used in the product is more natural, so I get a private benefit. So if I am inclined to nature based resources for my product, or the typical example is chemical free cosmetics or the cosmetics based on natural resources, that gives me private benefit, I am using something natural. But also it is a public benefit because it is giving the impact or the less impact on water recycling, CO2 reduction or such as biodiversity, right. Now the other example can be over here is that when we buy something, the energy saving product, in one way it gives us benefit because the operational cost associated with that is less, but in other way also the way whatever the bigger impact it could have been created in the process or the use, there is a public benefit associated with that. Now the challenge over here is that communicating the public benefit to consumer and making them ready to pay. So if it is private benefit, it is very clear, you can communicate that this is what the benefit you are getting from the product or the services, but communicating public benefit to the consumer and making them ready to pay because of public benefit or for public benefit, that is the bigger challenge associated with this. Now typically how the eco branding happens? The eco branding happens through the labeling, and what the label we call eco labels. So eco labeling in an environmental claim or any product signifying that it is an environmental friendly. So through the label we know that this is environmental friendly. So if you look at in our day to day usage of product also, we find there are numerous level associated. So the simplest example can be, if you are using, if you find a red dot, then it is non-vegetarian. If you find a green dot, then it is vegetarian. Similarly, if you find that there are three arrows there in the packaging, then the package can be recycled. And similarly, you will find typically for the cosmetics, no trial on, no animal testing. So these are some of the level what we get, or typically for the fair trade. So there are level what we get in the product. So all this product level is defined into or divided into three category of the leveling. Type 1, typically it is a multi-party agreement on criteria and third party certification. So the typical example of type 1 is FSC, that is responsible forestry, and this certification comes from the Forest Stewardship Council. Similarly, type 2, type 2 leveling is mostly in the packaging. It is provided by the manufacturer. So one of the example of type 2 is free range. So this is free range from some of the product which creates the environmental impact. And type 3, where you can find out whatever the impact created by the product. The typical example is Ecolip. So you will find that you will get a life cycle analysis of the product and how much impact they have been created in the different stage of the life cycle. Then this is the classification of eco level. Few of them are voluntary, few of them are mandatory, and you will find mostly this ISO type 1, type 2, type 3, till in many country or the many economy, it is still as the voluntary. And few of the example is that this is CFC free, which comes in the ISO type 2, or it is dolphin friendly mostly when it comes to the seafood product, or you get into the EPD. These are all voluntary in many cases or the many economy. But there are few of the mandatory thing like declaration of the content or the danger symbols or conformity with the standard. These are what consider in the mandatory category. So this is little bit old, the summarization, the eco leveling scheme in various countries by Childs and Whiting in 1998. It has changed over a period of time. So if you go to the UN site, they give the idea about the eco leveling that is being practiced in the different economic context or the different country context. These are few of the eco level that works in India, that is prevalent in India. Mostly the EcoMark is the one where it gives a level of environmental friendly product or the eco-friendly product. Now this entire eco-branding is from eco-leveling to eco-branding, because since you have to market the product, possibly just putting the level will not help to market the product as the eco-branded product or the environmental friendly product. So some of the example that where the transition have been taken place from the eco leveling to eco branding, like the example of Acer, one of the initial example where they were into the eco computer desktop and laptop, that is eco friendly computer. Similarly, your Wheels lifestyle, the environmental friendly clothing and support from the green cause. And you will find there are many more which comes under this lifestyle, where we talk about the handicraft or handloom, how the fair trade is being established, how it is support the green causes. Similarly, like natural fabric like handwoven wool from shepherds, natural silk, recycled junk jewelry, organic net, or eco joy toy made from sustainable wood source and organic cotton. These are few of the example where we bring it over here, which shows that over a period of time, it is just not about eco leveling. This is kind of a branding which has happened, that these are the environmental friendly products. Now, there are three basic prerequisites as identified by Reinhardt in 1999 to make the environmental friendly product into a successful one. First, consumer must be willing to pay for the cost of the ecological differentiation. So the first prerequisite is that the consumer should be ready to pay for the product. Second, reliable information about the product environmental performance must be available to the consumer. So, whatever information is associated with the product environmental performance, there should be transparency, there should be a way to reach that to the consumer, and differentiation should be such that it is difficult to imitate by the competitors. So, typically there should be barrier to imitation, willingness to pay, and there should be provision to provide the reliable information to the consumer. These are the three basic prerequisite for the successful for the success of a environmental friendly product, mostly in the category of the differentiation. Now, to do this, to make it a successful strategy, the consumer need to perceive a clear benefit for their purchase, which should offer the cost saving, better performance of the product, and the risk management. So, these are all private, but also when you talk about the risk management, it also leads to a public benefit. The typical example here is that when we buy a 5-star refrigerator or 5-star AC, what is the private benefit? The private benefit is, as I was discussing in the previous case also, there is a reduced energy cost. But by doing this also we are creating, since we are demanding less of energy, that leads to less of production of the energy, less of the impact associated with this. So, here typically we know that we are consuming something which is environmental friendly product, which is giving a clear benefit in term of the reduced operational cost in the private benefit category and reduced environmental impact in the public benefit category. So, for each of the product which is coming under environmental friendly product, the eco branding should be such that it gives a clear idea to the consumer or for what they are paying and what are the benefits associated with this. How they create competitive advantage? This is again, if they are meeting the prerequisite, if they are fulfilling the condition for a successful environmental friendly product, then it is easy to create a competitive advantage. First one, uncontroversial information about the environmental performance is available. It should be whatever information needed about the performance of the product, the inputs of the product, the environmental performance of the product, that should be available. Whatever the differentiation the organization is doing in term of product differentiation, there should be difficult to imitate. And customer, they are ready to pay or willing to pay for the cost of the ecological differentiation. And ideally, in order to get the competitive advantage, at a point of time the public benefit and private benefit should converge. Now, let us get into our fourth strategy, that is strategy for four, that is environmental cost leadership. This is considered to be the most difficult strategy, because in this strategy we are not only lowering the cost, also lowering the environmental impact. So, environmental cost leadership is that through the actions, through the way the changes happening in the product and services, it will optimize both the cost associated with this and also the environmental impact associated with this. Now, the focus over here is the lower cost and the changes needed in the product and services. Now, how this is being done? Typically, radical product innovation for lower environmental impact by using the material substitution and the dematerialization. So, it has to be use of innovation, use of technology through the material substitution and through dematerialization, that will give us less of environmental impact. And the lower cost product is typically passed to the consumer, because if the innovation and if the cost of innovation is being passed to the consumer, possibly the market, again in the, at least in the initial stage, the product may not be successful, the product may not get profit for the organization. So, the next challenge is that, the first challenge is through the innovation, how to reduce the environmental impact associated with the product. But second, even if you are doing innovation or the changes in the technology, it should not create a higher cost for the consumer. So this has to be also available at a lower cost of the product, and that is why this is known as the most difficult strategy to achieve or most difficult strategy to practice. Now if you take the examples, there is one example over here in Ecolean packaging is that they did whatever the changes with the packaging, they offer that at 25% cheaper than the competitor. The inputs what they use, no FDA approval required, and when at the end of the product is when it is giving disposed through the incinerator, it reduces the acidity of the fumes. So if it looks like a environmental friendly product, because they are using the inputs and also the environmental friendly inputs, and also at the end of end level also the impact is less, and they are offering it at also 25% less than the competitor. Yet the company does not market this, consumer are not ready to pay, because if you are the typical problem over here in this example is that if you are delivering something good, then why at a lower cost? So the consumers typically they always behave in both the way. One, if the higher price is being charged for a better product, they get skeptic that why should we pay more if the real benefits are not known. And if you are charging a lower price and still you are offering something good, then also they are skeptic, because that if there is something good, why the price is reduced? Because the perception, so the basic economic principle is that the Veblen effect works always. So unless we are not valuing quality, we are not ready to pay more. So unless the perception of higher price is not associated with higher quality, consumer they are not ready to pay, and they always put that in the category of the luxury goods. Similarly, few of the other example which comes under environmental cost leadership is IKEA's flat packaging reduces the transport cost and emission, and the typical example of biofuel which is less environmental impact and also the cost associated with that is low. So now let's summarize all the four environmental strategy what we discussed. So strategy 1, eco-efficiency. Strategy 2, beyond compliance leadership. Strategy 3, eco branding, and strategy 4, environmental cost leadership. So when we put them into the matrix, we see that for strategy 1 and strategy 2, the changes, the competitive focus is process, the changes needed in the organization process, and for strategy 3 and 4, the competitive focus is on the product and services, or the changes needed in the product and services. In case of when we are taking this, that what creates the competitive advantage for this strategy? For strategy 1 and strategy 4, lowering the cost or the lower cost creates the competitive advantage, and for strategy 2 and strategy 3, the differentiation what the company offers in term of their process, in term of their activity, in term of their product and services, that creates the competitive advantage. So all these four strategies being summarized here in term of their competitive focus, and also the through what attributes they create the competitive advantage. Now any advantage, so we know that in the previous slide, it when we the organization they practices this strategy, it creates competitive advantage. So all this competitive advantage, either they get a cost advantage, or they get a product differentiation advantage, or they get a strategic advantage. So if you find all these three advantage is summarized in a triangle, each tip of this triangle is one of the advantage. So what comes under cost advantage? The changes in the manufacturing process and the material usage that can yield the cost saving more than offset the development and the implementation cost. Whatever the cost saving is being done, if they are offsetting the development and implementation cost, then we get the cost advantage. In case of product differentiation advantage, it increases the market share, it revives the old mature product and create new market segment. And in case of strategic advantage, because of this pro environmental action, like the example of beyond compliance leadership, that can lead to strategic advantage by developing a patented product technology or re-engineering facility in a way that allow company to distance itself from the competitor. So in fact, if they are creating a product technology, if they are creating a re-engineering facility, that creates a barrier to the other firms to come and operate in that specific space or specific market. So here the Forrest-Reinhart model will just try to summarize this strategy using the Forrest-Reinhart model, that how they have managed, what is the model says about managing the environmental issues or the simple intervention or the clear intervention needed in which part of the business processes which will manage the environmental issues. First, invest in environmental friendly process and product. Managing the environmental regulation, invest in environmental performance improvement without increasing the cost. So if you are doing the investing in environmental friendly process and product, this comes under your eco-efficiency. Also, you will find that this can be part of your eco-branding, because you are doing a or you are producing a different product and also you are being positioned as the environmental friendly product. When you manage the environmental regulations through the self-regulation and also through reacting to the governance or the governance policy, this can be, this can come under, this activity can come under the beyond compliance leadership. Similarly, the third one, when we are investing the environmental performance improvement without increasing cost, like the typical example here, if the input consumption can be reduced by effective recycling, then the product price need not be increase, higher price need not be imposed to recover the investment made, comes under the environmental cost leadership. And when we combine all three methods or all four methods coming under the different strategy, the it changes the basis for competition and redefine market, and both the firms and environment can benefit. So if you look at all this example, it is not that the organization has to think of a strategy and put some intervention. So whatever the intervention is being done in the process, product, or with respect to reacting to the regulation, compliance to the regulation, all this activity, all this intervention comes under one of the strategy what we have discussed in this matrix, that is the competitive environmental strategy. So in the next class, we will try to take some examples and we will see whatever the initiative they have taken, how to map together into the part of the competitive environmental strategy. Thank you.